get out of the way. Come on, brother. Take over up here.
Amen.
Praise God.
I'm thankful for that blood of Jesus that washes whiter than snow. And that washes, you know, it's kind of like, you know, taking those stains out. That'll Clorox that we buy with that bleach, and it is pretty effective at taking those stains out of our clothes, isn't it? But I don't know about you, but I've got times where there's a few stains where it might have helped, but it didn't completely wash it completely clean. But the blood of Jesus, it fully accomplishes that.
Amen.
But it only accomplishes it if it's applied, right?
That's right.
If you take that Clorox, if you don't apply it to them clothes, it won't take those stains out, right? It's only when you apply the blood of Jesus that it can do the washing that it needs. And it's applied to us when we trust in Jesus Christ. Amen. A few announcements this morning. Ladies, I want to remind you that the Women's Fellowship is going to be on Friday, November 18th at 6:30. Again, we're going to have Tammy Melton with y'all to share her testimony. So I want to encourage you to come out for that, and also encourage you to bring your favorite finger foods for a time of eating and fellowship along with that. Also want to let you know that we are having our annual children's Christmas program. It's going to be on Sunday, December 11th at 6 o'clock in the afternoon, and we'll have a time of fellowship to follow after that. Practice has started on Wednesday nights, so if you have any children, you know of any children that would like to be part of that, come on Wednesday nights at 6:30 for the practice. And
ladies' meeting was Friday night.
Oh, okay. Yep. Thank you for clarifying that. So I wanted to be sure to put it on there because we had it. So that was Friday night. But again, on the Children's Christmas Program, the practices are on Wednesday nights at 6:30 p.m. So if you have any others that are interested in that or want to participate, please see Ms. Pam. She'll have some more information on that. This Tuesday night, it's going to be Lesson 5 entitled Turn. I want to remind everyone that the snacks start at 6 o'clock and the meeting is at 6:30 for that, and child care is provided there. And in regards to our Operation Christmas Child, the boxes, they have been sent off, and so we've completed that ministry for this year, and beginning in January, we will start that back up yet again, and first part of January, we'll start announcing those particular items that we'll begin the Operation Christmas Child Ministry with there. And those are the few main announcements we have this morning. Let's continue on to the Lord and thank Him. I know that our attendance is a little lower this week. I know of several people I've talked to that are sick, and several are already going out of town for the Thanksgiving holiday. But nonetheless, what does the Word of God say? You know, we're two or more.
Yes, amen.
Amen. So, I would love for every pew in here to be filled. But one thing I want even more is to this place to be filled with the presence of God. Amen.
Amen.
So let's join in together and let's just ask the Lord to just fill this place with His presence to the fullest as we worship Him. Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, we do come before You, Lord, humbly and thankfully, Lord, that we have this opportunity to just openly and publicly just to praise and to worship You, Father, Lord, to just sing songs about Your glory and Your goodness, Father, Lord, and to receive Your word, Father, without any resistance or persecution, Father. Let us not take that for granted, Father. It's such a blessing that we have here, even today, Father. And Lord, I just pray, Lord, that we would just commit our all to You, Father. May we devote our heart's affection and our mind's attention solely upon You today, Father. May there be no distractions, Father. Lord, if there's any sin that may interfere, Father, may we come to the foot of the cross, Father, Lord, and seek forgiveness, Father, Lord. And just as that song said, Lord, may we be washed white as snow. May we be covered in the righteousness of Christ this morning, Father. Lord, may Your presence abound in this place as we magnify and glorify Your great name as we receive Your word today, Father. Lord, I thank you, Father, for what you're going to accomplish through your word. I thank you, Father, for your perfect will being accomplished in this place today, Father. May all that's done in here, Father, Lord, be to your honor, to your praise and glory. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord. You know, I was wondering why I sounded so much better here than I did do when I'm practicing at home. I got a little old microphone at home.
These things are called vocal pros. Vocal pros.
Now you know why I sound so good. Got a vocal pro up here. Praise God. Amen. Let me see. I got a list here. Are you washed in the blood? I'm staying on that blood of Jesus. Amen. Because one drop of it was for me. Can you say amen?
Amen.
This song's kind of totally different from the last one. And it's one of them moving on kind of songs. Speed it up a little bit. Amen. Let's see what we can do here. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let me get some volume here, but not that much. Serving him.
Amen.
If you feel like getting out there and dancing for the Lord, go ahead on. I'm not going to try to stop you. Amen. Woo, glory to God. I got me some stuff mixed up here. It ain't no alcohol. But I'm filled with the Spirit of God, so I might act a little strange anyway. Amen. These are not drunk on wine as you suppose. That's what Peter said, wasn't it? But this is that which was spoken of by the prophet Joel. Amen. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Amen. That's honey lemon. In case y'all was wondering, what's he got in there? They keep telling me at work, we want some of that what you got. You can get it. It's for all of whosoever will. Let them come. Amen. I got to find this next song here. Some way, somehow. There's my Sunday school notes. You want to hear about Sunday school? Know what we had in there? We had a good time in there, too.
Amen.
Amen. Everybody in Sunday school, you have a good time.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. I got to find this song right here. Let's see here. Here we go. That's not the Bible.
Wrong one.
Well, glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. They ain't wanting to cooperate. There it is. All right, we're going to get back to it here. I bet you thought, what's wrong with that guy? Y'all thought that several times, hadn't you?
Yep.
Amen. Who said that? Was that my wife? She's going to be walking home. One of y'all going to carry her home? Praise God. Amen. This song is called Yes, I Know, and it's got some scriptures that I'm going to read as this song is being introduced.
Make the violent sinner clean.
I know Jesus' blood can make the violent sinner clean. And I know, yes, I know, Jesus' blood can make the violent sinner clean. Jesus' blood can make the violent sinner clean. Say thank you, Jesus, right now. Praise God. These things I have written to you who believeth in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have everlasting life. Can you say amen? Praise his name. Jesus' blood can make you clean this morning. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Amen. Praise his name. Glory to God. We're going to get one more in here. One more.
All right.
Praise God. One more. Not one more time. That means I'm going to sing the song over again. If I said one more time, I'm going to play it again. Ain't you ever heard any, been in a concert where they said one more time?
Yep.
Praise, I like that. That's the way I do in my concerts. I said, when have you ever had a concert? I've had concerts, believe me. Y'all don't know all about me. Something you don't want to know. Praise God.
Amen.
Who said that? Amen, brother. Let's see right here. I got right back to this list that time. Amen. This is an old song right here. Picking up an old one. Are you having a good time in the Lord this morning?
Amen.
Amen. Y'all feeling good, it'll be a lot easier for him to preach. When he reads a scripture and you like it, say amen.
Amen.
Or say, preach it, brother.
Amen.
Or you're stepping on my toes. No, don't say that. Just take it. Amen. If the word gets on you, you probably need it getting on. Praise God. All right, one more right here. We're going to get out of the way.
At Lowe's, it's Provem, which means Lowe's and Peace members.
Hey, that's a good one. Amen.
That's old country gospel right there, isn't it? Of course.
all temptations where the roses never fade. Oh, here they bloom, but for a season. Oh, and soon
preaching and our singing in together, so we'll just close out in a word of prayer and say amen. I think we'll come up with something new, brother. We call it preening, where you mix the preaching and the singing in all at one time and get it all together. But I appreciate the word, Lord, and I thank you for what you shared with us, and I appreciate you leading us into worship this morning. If we'd have our children to come forward, please. Yeah, I kind of hesitated there for a second.
I had to put that microphone.
We got any children to come forward with us? And while they're coming forward, I want to share one thing with you real quickly. Miss Wynn had found a key out in the parking lot. It's a Dodge key, and it's got like a little orangish ring to it. So, okay. I'll have it in my coat pocket here, and I'll give it to you. Actually, I'll tell you what, so I don't forget. Oh, thank you. Go ahead and get it to you. Well, I could have just waited and see who was still standing in the parking lot after everybody else had left. That might have gotten it across to you. Amen. All right, if you will, let's go, Lord, and let's thank Him for these children we have, and thank Him for our opportunity to worship Him through our tithes and offerings. Let's go, Lord. Father in heaven, we thank You for these children, Lord, and we thank You, Father, for Your blessings that's going to be upon them, Father. We thank You for the anointing upon Your word, Lord, and we ask Your anointing to be upon the teachers, Father. Lord, to speak life, to speak truth to them, Father. Lord, that they may receive and know, Lord, how good of a God You are, Father, Lord, and how great You are and how greatly You are to be praised, Father, Lord, and how You can be trusted, Lord, and how they can walk in obedience and service to You, Father. Lord, just may they know Your great love, Father, that they would grow even greater in their love towards You, Father. Lord, we thank You for this opportunity we have to worship You through tithes and offerings. Lord, may we give in pure worship this morning, Father. Lord, giving thankfully and joyfully, Father, trusting in You, Father, to provide for all of our needs. Lord, and it's through the name of Jesus that we pray these things. Amen. Continue on into Romans chapter 1 and verse 1. This is the third week of us starting into Romans, and I would apologize for still being on the first verse, but I'm not going to apologize for that because, as I mentioned before, we're not going to get down to those pearls by skimming over it.
Come on, man.
And this first verse has so much in it. As I mentioned before, to me, Romans is one of the greatest books in the Bible. And I believe that's one of the reasons why it's one of the first epistles that you find behind the Gospels. But even with this being the first epistle, the first verse of this first epistle that we come to has so much in it that I wanted to make sure that we spent due time and due diligence in digging out the truth of God's Word, because I think it has so much to speak to us. So this morning we're going to get into the second part of this first verse, but if you'll follow along with me, we'll read this first verse again and go Lord in prayer, and we'll see what words of wisdom God has for us this morning. So Romans chapter 1 and verse 1 again, it says, Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God. Amen. Let's go Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you again. Lord, how blessed it is, Father, to be in your house, Father, and to be able to receive your word. Father, I pray that your spirit would just speak so loudly to us, Father. Lord, we know that your word will accomplish what you purpose it, Father. Lord, and I just pray, Lord, that we are prepared, Father, to receive all that you have purposed for us today, Father. Lord, may the power of your word that's sharper than any two-edged sword, Lord, that's able to pierce into the very marrow of our soul, Father. Lord, just do a perfect work in us today, Father. Lord, to help us to grow in wisdom, Father. Not just knowledge in the head, Father, but wisdom that we can apply to our life, Father, to help us to understand how great you are, Father. Lord, and how grateful we are to you, Father, for what you've done for us, Father. Lord, to encourage us and to prepare us, Father, to live as your sons and daughters in this world. We just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So again, we're into the second part of this first verse, and that's where we see it says, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of Amen. God. And the very first word that we see there is that word called.
Come on.
Paul says that he was called to be an apostle. So was it his idea to go and to do all that he had done? Why did Paul dedicate his life to serving the Lord and doing all that he had done for the sake of Christ and for the sake of Christianity?
Come on.
Was it him that said, hey, I like that. I think I'll choose to do that.
Amen.
It was not his choice, but it was the Christ Jesus choice for him. And it was Jesus that called him.
Glory.
Not that Paul was a volunteer, kind of like what we have volunteers in the jobs that we have. Most all of you, if any of you are like me and still work a job, what's the most likely way that you got that job? You went in and volunteered for the job and they accepted you, right? Or that's what happened in my case. They posted a job position saying, hey, we're looking for someone to do this job, and this is what we'll give you as compensation. I saw that, I liked it, and I said, I'll go and offer to do that job for what they're offering me. And then then agreement is made, and we go on. But what Paul is saying here, that it is not like some posted job that he went and applied for. He was called. He was sovereignly chosen by God and called by God. So this is similar to what we see to the other apostles. Jesus told his apostles, we see it in John chapter 15 and verse 16, you did not choose me, but I chose you.
Amen.
We also see in Acts chapter 19, verses 15 and 16, it says, he, that is Paul, is a chosen instrument of mine.
Praise
and we see here how Paul was called, how he was chosen. And he also mentions in Galatians chapter 1, verses 15 and 16, God set me apart from my mother's womb and called me. And so what we see here, it says that he was set apart from his mother's womb. So was it like Paul was born and lived his life and just happened to come across Christ and like, oh, hey, I got something I'd like for you to do for me.
Come on now.
When was the decision for Paul to be chosen for the work that God gave him to do? It was from his mother's womb. In essence, before he was ever born, God had purposed and planned the work that Paul was to do for him. Before the world was created, before time began, God had marked his life and predestined Paul to preach this gospel to the Gentiles.
Amen.
And why does that matter to us? What does it matter what God had done through Paul and called him to do? God had marked a path for Paul to walk in. And it's important for us to understand this, is because just what God had done for Paul, God has also done for each and every one of us that believes in Christ Jesus. Just as God has called us to salvation, God has called us into a purpose also. God has marked a path for every one of us. And that, just as in Paul, that path has been pre-planned and pre-purposed for each and every one of us.
Amen.
To walk in service to him. As I mentioned before, it's not like he at the last minute saw Paul and made a on-the-spot decision, hey, yeah, I need to do something with him. It was pre-planned and was purposed before Paul was ever even born. And so God has marked the same path for us. And God has had this path for you and for me pre-planned, that he's called us and destined for us to walk in before we were ever even born. And the reason for this is because God is a previous God. God goes before all things because he knows all things. So God has not only called you into salvation, but God has, with that call of salvation, has called you into service also. All who are called to salvation are called to service. And that's some specific task that God has given us to serve him in. And when we find what that calling is, when we find the greatest joy, when we find that little niche or that aspect of where God has called for us to serve him in. So Paul was called. And just like Paul was called, so we too are called. And it says that Paul himself was called to be an apostle. Now, what does that word apostle mean? A lot of people have misunderstandings of this, or they cross over what some of those meanings mean there. And that word apostle in itself, in essence, means a sent one. It is one that is sent with a special commission or a specific task.
Yes.
It's kind of like what we have as ambassadors. You might have heard that word associated with this before. But it's like one who is sent on the behalf of someone else. Amen. And that word apostle, it is used kind of in a general way to specify all of those who were the helpers of the 13 apostles. All sent ones are, in essence, ambassadors of God. Now, at a higher level, this word apostle was referred to one who had received direct revelation from God themselves. And we see that through the main apostles, those disciples, those apostles that we had that received direct revelation from Jesus Christ. These are the ones that are the authors of the New Testament Scripture, or they're also the ones that received direct revelation from God that were also the supporters of those writings. But in essence, these apostles who had received the direct revelation of God are ones who had authority over the church because they were the direct representatives of the one who is head over all the church. And who is the head of the church? That is Jesus Christ himself. And so why does Paul mention here? He specifies that he is called. But he specifies that he is called to be an apostle. Now why is that important that we know this? Why was it important for him to specify that he was an apostle? Well, he mentions that he is apostle because what is in his letter, it has authority in the church. It's not just some common message that he is writing to the church there in Rome, to the people in Rome. He is writing because he is writing what he has received as the direct revelation from God himself. Is it safe to say that Paul wrote the book of Romans? Amen. Is it safe to say that God wrote the book of Romans?
Amen. Come on.
It is. Because God, through direct revelation to Paul, wrote the book of Romans. Therefore, God wrote the book of Romans through Paul as he wrote the book of Romans. Amen. It is the Paul was a mouthpiece for Jesus. And what he had spoken and what he had written is the infallible truth of the Word of God that we see here. So he makes that point specific there. That what he has written in the book of Romans, that he was writing at that time to the church and the people in Rome, was direct revelation, infallible truth from God himself. So that they would realize and understand that this isn't just some message to be heard. It is the spoken word of God that is to be received. And that has that same weightiness to us even here today. That the book of Romans that God wrote through Paul, as we read and as we study and as we hear it preached upon, is God also speaking unto us. So the next part that we see here is that set apart for. That Paul was set apart for the gospel of God. Amen. So in other words, Paul was separated from this the temporal of this world, and he was a set apart to eternal and heavenly things. Then we see, as I mentioned before, that God had marked out a path for Paul to spread the gospel as far and as wide as possible. And man, did Paul put in the work to accomplish that. He went and he did at the sake of all resistance, of all persecution, despite all the hardships and the headaches and the troubles that he faced. He was a man on a mission to accomplish what God had purposed him to do. And that ultimate purpose was for him to use that avenue, that path that God had given them, to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ as far and as wide as he possibly could. And just as Paul speaks here that he was set apart, we too are set apart. All of those who are born again believers in Christ Jesus have been set apart for the gospel. You know, we go about, even ourselves, we become busy about many things.
Come on.
There's a lot of things that we have to do with our time. We have, many have jobs that they go to, children to raise. There's a lot of things that we occupy our time with. But even as in the times that you have gone through, you know, even at times when you were younger, the things that you were doing, we have a lot of different things that we do in our lives. But at the very tip of that direction in our life is that goal of accomplishing this same thing, that is the spreading of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And do we see that everything that we do in our life, do we see it through that avenue of glorifying God and advancing the gospel of God in this world? When we see things through this lens in our life, it changes our aspect about a lot of different things.
Amen.
If my goal in my life was for me to get the greatest job, to make the most amount of money, to live comfortable and provide the greatest things I could for my family, for my children, then everything is going to be filtered through that lens. And so all I'm going to see in my life is that path of climbing that career ladder to accomplish that objective. And whenever I see something in my life that's going, that takes an alternate course than achieving that ultimate objective that I have, as far as my career being my top objective, then I'm going to see things completely different than what they are really intended to be. Say, for instance, I get a job as a manager, and then something happens, you know, say somebody gossips and spread lies or something, and the company believes it, and so they knock me down from a manager to being a stalker in a truck, a truck loader. Then what happens if my objective is to get the highest position, to get the highest money, to live the most comfortable life and to provide the greatest things for my family, I'm not achieving that objective. I'm going backwards, right? Well, those kind of same things have happened in my life. And when I was younger, I had that mentality. And I would be, I had a lot of anger and resentment to the jobs that I had and the things that I was doing because that was my goal and that was my objective. But that is not the lens that I see through. That is not my ultimate goal in life anymore. My ultimate goal in life is now to see, to accomplish the very thing we see Paul trying to accomplish in his life, and that is to share and to get the gospel as far and as wide as possible.
Amen.
Out
Amen.
There. And I remember back when I was an associate pastor, about the time I became associate pastor, I was moved to a different position. It was a different position that the pay was different, and the but also with the pay being different, the amount of dedication and the overtime and stuff was different. So I didn't make the money that I was making. But I was fine with that because that was not my ultimate goal anymore. I was glad not to have the position and not to have the responsibilities and to have another job that had less responsibilities, that took up less time and less hours to focus on that work because it allowed more time to do what was at the point of my life's motivation at that point then, and that is to serve in ministry and to get that gospel out there. And so it had a complete change, and it had a complete outlook. We work and do many things, but it is all to serve this one ultimate objective, and that is to get the gospel out there. It is not just to be on this earth, to be saved, and to come on Sundays, maybe on Wednesdays, or maybe go to a few revivals here and there and everywhere, and just to be thankful for the Lord for saving us and enjoying His the salvation that He's given us, and to just worship Him on this earth until it's time to leave this earth. If that was our only objective, is to just sit around here, enjoy the benefits of salvation, and worship God for the salvation He gave us, we would not be here on this earth right now at this moment. We would be in heaven, thanking God for the salvation He's given us and worshiping Him. Because I promise you, the worship in heaven is much better than the worship it is down here.
Amen.
And if that's all that God wanted us to do, then God would have us in heaven there before Him, worship Him, and praising Him, singing to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords directly instead of down here. But we were here, we're still on this earth, and we're still on this earth for this reason, to find and fulfill that master plan that God has for us to be able to get the gospel out. That's the reason we're still on this earth. All who are born again believers are in what I would say is the broadcasting business.
Come on now.
We are all broadcasters.
Yes.
And you think, well, you know, I've never worked in news, I've never worked in television, or I've never worked in radio. But that word broadcasting, it comes from the idea of just from two words, broad and cast. And the original out of this that came from was the spreading of seed over a large area.
Come on, yes.
You know, first thing that may come to mind when we think of broadcasting, we think of television and radio. Well, that's a word that they use for that broadcasting, but it comes from that concept of taking a seed and sowing it or flinging it broadly across land.
Amen.
To broadly cast that seed out for sowing. And that's where they got the same idea. It's not seed that they're trying to broadly cast out. It's information or entertainment or whatever it may be. But that's where that concept comes from, to broadly cast out whatever it is they're wanting to be, whether it be for TV or radio or internet or anything else. It comes from that concept of broadly flinging or casting out seed for sowing. In Luke chapter 8 and verse 5, it says, "A sower went out to sow seed." And that's what it's talking about here. A sower going out and broadcasting that seed. And as he sowed, as he broadcasted that seed, some fell by the wayside and it was trampled, and the birds in the air devoured it. So again, that word broadcast came from spreading of the seed over a large area. And I talked about how television and radio and all these other media outlets, they use that word broadcasting for the broadly spreading out of news or information or whatever else it may be. But it came from broadcasting of seed. Do you know what the Word of God is? It's the seed. Luke chapter 8 and verse 11, it says, "Now the parable is this." As he's explaining what the parable of the sower is, he says, "The seed is the Word of God."
Yes.
Television, radio, they may be crossing seeds of information and entertainment and all these other things. But we, my dear friends, are to be broadcasters and to be those sowers broadly spreading the seed of the Word of God, the seed of the gospel of God.
Amen.
As far and wide as we possibly can. And that's what we're set apart for. The next thing that we see in here is that we see that word gospel. It says the gospel of God.
Amen.
And I have to ask, because I was surprised to find out, I heard another seminary teacher talk about how many students come into seminary and they have to ask this initial question to them, because even though they're coming to be future preachers or teachers or theologians or whatever the case may be, they have an initial lack of understanding of even what the gospel of God is. What does gospel mean? In essence, it means simply good news.
Amen.
And the gospel is indeed good news. Amen?
Amen.
Well, the actual word of that that we see here is that word euangelion. Euangelion. You, when you say that word out, what's one of the word, key words that you hear in there? Euangelion. You hear that word angel in there, right? What is an angel? Do you know? An angel is a messenger of God. And an angelion is that message. Angelion is that message that an angel, a messenger of God, delivers. Now, in this word gospel, in the root euangelion, we see a prefix to that, and it's that word EU. EU. And that word simply means good. There's another word that we often use that has that EU in front of it. And I used, and it simply means good. And the word is eulogy. You know, when Miss Doris had passed away, I came and gave what we call a eulogy at her funeral. And what did I say that word EU means? It means good. When the word eulogy, that last word is logos. And that word simply means word. So to give a eulogy is to give a EU good logos word. And that's what eulogy means, to give a good word. But here we see that EU in front of angelion. So what did we say angelion is? A message. Euangelion is a good message or good news. But here's the thing, I say good news, but it's not really good news. It is great news.
Amen.
It is the greatest news that you and I have ever heard and we will ever hear in this entire life. It's that good news of salvation that we who are separated from God and is on this path of destruction can be saved from. Because of our sin, we are separated and we're on a path to eternal destruction because of our sin. But the good news of salvation, it is to all of those who are on the who are separated and on this path. But God has sent His Son into this world to live in our place and to die in our place and to rescue all who are sinners from this eternal destruction. So, and that's what salvation ultimately is. Salvation is deliverance from destruction. We are delivered from the deserved judgment and wrath of God. Do you know that because of our sin, that's what we deserve? We deserve God's judgment and God's wrath. And we see that in Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. The next part that I want to take a look at here is after looking at the gospel, what do we see behind that? Whose gospel? The gospel of God. And it's important for us to understand this part of it. Because who came up with the gospel? Did a bunch of smart people like the Einsteins and the Teslas or other wise people in this world, did they all get together and have a group think and come up with this great plan of salvation for us? No, it didn't come from this world. It came from God. God is the sole author, not only the author, but the architect of this gospel, this good news. This gospel, it comes from God. God is the source of it. It has come from the very throne of God Himself. It wasn't devised in this world. It was devised from God in His throne room in heaven, and it came down to us from Him. So literally, we can say that the gospel is an out-of-this-world message. Both literally and figuratively, it is a message that is out of this world. And to me, I think that it's so out of this world because the gospel is so simple to that even the youngest of children can understand it. But yet it is so complex that the most intelligent minds that's ever walked this earth have been unable to come together and conceive such a great plan for our salvation. I mean, just think of the different concepts that are wrapped up in the gospel message. We have the virgin birth. We have God coming in human flesh. We have God's son being born under God's own law. How God's son Jesus obeyed the law perfectly, which fulfilled all righteousness on our account. And then willingly going to such a hellish cross to die for all of us. We see it in the word that he who knew no sin became sin that we might obtain the righteousness of Christ. Amen. What I call the great exchange. Man, what a wonderful plan for such a great exchange to happen. And it was all part of God's authored plan. He devised it. He came up with the great idea and set it into perfect motion for all of us. We have all sinned. And Jesus went to have all the sin of all the people who have ever lived and believed in Christ to be transferred to him. Now, what wise mind here on earth would have had the understanding to know that God could place all of the sins of every person who would believe on Christ upon him at one time, and that penalty for centuries and millions of people who have sinned, for that payment to be applied to one person at all at one time? We never would have come up with such a thing. Well, we see that in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. We never in our lifetime would have come up with such a sin-bearing substitute for Jesus, the Son of God, on that cross. But if you think about it, could you come up with what you think our plan might be for salvation? If it weren't for God and his perfect plan, if it was left up to us, what would we try to do to enter into heaven? I can tell you exactly what we would do. I know with great confidence, and it would be this, that we would devise a grand plan for us to be able to earn our salvation. It's exactly what we would have done. We would have worked to try to make some way that we could work our way into heaven. A way that we could climb that ladder by our own efforts, by our own struggles, to be able to enter into heaven. And how can I say with such certainty is that's what we would do? Because all other religions that we see, all other false religions that we see here on earth,
amen,
that even believes in an afterlife, this is their attempt to try to obtain that heavenly afterlife. Every other false religion that believes in the afterlife, this is what they strive to do, to try to earn that salvation. So God's plan of salvation. And a lot of people who don't believe have a hard time believing this. So you explain the gospel to them, and they make it even repeat it back to you. So you're telling me that God's plan of salvation for me is for this man Jesus to pay the price on the sin for my sin on the cross, and that he died on that cross, and then he was buried in this tomb, and then 3 days later he was raised from the dead, and as he walked out of that grave, he walked out with the keys of that grave, the keys of death in his hand, in his resurrection, that he overcome death in the grave, and then he ascends to the Father, and now whoever calls upon the name of this Jesus as Lord and Savior, that they can be saved. And they say, in essence, so in other words, in all this concept, you're saying that my eternal destination depends on a crucified and killed Jew.
Amen.
And I say, yes, that's the point exactly. And you can't believe it until you understand that that person who died was not just a crucified Jew.
Come on.
Just like the people in Jesus' day, even his own family, the people from his own town, is this not the carpenter's son? Is this man not just another carpenter? Is he not just another Jew? Absolutely not. He is the very Son of God. He was a son of God, both the Son of God and both the Son of Man, that secured salvation for all of humanity on that cross of Calvary. This is the good news.
Come on.
And what makes this good news, this great news, even greater, is to know that it is free. That it is freely given. And I share all this with you, and we spend so much time on this at the very beginning, because this kind of sets the stage for the whole book of Romans.
Amen.
Romans opens up the fullness of this great gospel plan for salvation to us. And that's why he opens with this very first word, that or very first part, that he is called to spread this good news, this gospel, to all mankind. And I save what I think the most important word for last.
Come on.
It's a simple three-letter word that oftentimes in our conversations doesn't carry any much weight on its work on its own, but this word carries so much weight that we must understand.
Amen.
For the gospel message to be true to us. And it's a simple word spelled T-H-E, the gospel of God. That word, the, specifies one.
Amen.
There is one and only gospel. It is exclusive. Because you will not find anywhere else, anyone else, that has done what Jesus has done for us.
Amen.
This is, my dear friends, the one and only way of salvation for us. And we see that clearly in John chapter 14 and verse 6. Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. That spells it out pretty clearly for me. But in case we still have any questions about it, he goes on to explain it even deeper. No one comes to the Father except through me. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the only way to come to the Father. He is the only way to have salvation and to enter into heaven. And understanding this, if we still try to look for any alternatives, it proves to us to be eternally fatal to do so. And God gives us clear warning of this through His Word. A few verses of Scripture to help us understand this. Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 12. There is a way that seems right to a man, but its ends is the way of death.
Amen.
See, many people don't want to accept Jesus as the way.
All right.
They want to believe that there are other ways to the Father except through Jesus. But those ways are the ways of death. It warns us. Also in Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go in by it, because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life. And there are few who finds it. In my own head, a lot of times, I like to call it the one man wide gate. Because there's only one man that is the path to enter through to God and to heaven. But adding to that, Acts chapter 4 and verse 12, nor is there salvation in any. What does any mean? Do we understand that word?
Come on.
Any means any. For there is There is no salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. I pray that that has made it clear that Jesus is indeed the way, the truth, and the life this morning. We also see in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 5 through 7, for there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time, for which I was appointed a preacher and an apostle. I am speaking the truth in Christ and not lying, a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and in truth. He wanted to make it clear to them, what I'm telling you is the truth. I'm not lying to you. Amen. And just as he is saying it here, I say it to you also. I'm telling you the truth. I'm not lying to you. Jesus is the way, the only way. The gospel is the only solution to man's greatest problem. Do you remember what I said that problem is? Our sin. This great problem that we have, the gospel is the only solution to it. And the only way to receive the benefits of the gospel is to, what does it say? Does it say, peek in that narrow gate or take a step into the narrow gate? What does it say? It says to enter into that narrow gate. You have to fully commit and walk in and walk through that door, to walk through that gate that's there. Not to just step one foot in or peek around the door, but to enter in, to walk fully into. One must believe in Jesus as God's Son. One must repent, that is to turn from your sins. Not just to have a change of mind, but to have a change of mind. Not to just ask for forgiveness, but to have a change of mind and to turn from your sins and turn to the Lord Jesus and put your faith in Jesus Christ. But Jesus Christ alone.
Amen.
I can't remember where I heard this saying from. I think it's actually part of a hymn song that they sing. But it says, nothing in my hand I bring, simply to the cross I cling.
Yes.
And it is only by grasping a hold of Jesus Christ and holding fast in faith and trust in Him as your Lord and your Savior. Are you, as David sung so wonderfully about the blood of Jesus being applied to us, as we hold on to Jesus, it is though that blood of Jesus running off of Him and running on to us to cleanse us from our sins and to save us from the judgment and the wrath of God for all of eternity. It is only through Jesus. And it is only through Jesus alone. That, my dear friends, is the greatest news that we can ever receive.
Amen.
But it is also the greatest news that we can ever share. And that's what Paul purposed his life to. That's what he was called for, and that's what he was purposed to. My dear friends, that is what we are all called for and purposed to as long as we live on this earth. We're not here to enjoy the benefits of God's salvation here. We'll have a much greater time doing that in heaven. We are called unto salvation. But with that call of salvation calls a call unto service as He separates us for the work He has planned and purposed to us to accomplish this great objective, to be broadcasters and to spread the seed of the gospel as far and as wide as we possibly can. As far as we can. If you would, please stand with me.
Praise Him. Glory to God.
If I could have every head bowed and every eye closed for just a few moments.
Praise Him.
as we've looked at God's Word and He's made it clear to us that through believing faith and trust in Jesus Christ alone is the only way of salvation for us. Does that speak to you today? Have you chosen by faith to put your trust in Jesus Christ as both your Lord and your Savior? If you haven't, the bad news is the wages of your sin are still applied to you. That payment, those wages of sin, which is death, has to be satisfied, either by you or by another. God's already done the work on the cross to provide that payment for your sins. The only work that you must do is to step in faith and trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And in receiving Jesus, you receive that free gift of salvation that He provides with it. If you're here this today and you've not taken that step of faith and trusted in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, would you choose this day? If the Spirit of God is working inside of you, show Him your need, your desperate need for Jesus as your Savior. Would you answer His call to you today? Have a time of altar call. If you've made that choice today, if you'd like to come forward, we would love to talk with you about that decision. If not, we'd ask that you fill out that form to let us know so that we could contact you later. The altars are open. If anyone would like to come forward and spend time with the Lord, or if you have a prayer request or anything that you'd like to bring before the Lord, I'd invite you to come. Is there anyone that would come? Anyone that would come. Amen. May we leave this place knowing that we have a greater purpose through the great calling of Jesus Christ to serve Him and to get the gospel out there as much as we can. It's good news. Usually if we have something else that good happened to us, we don't have a problem telling everybody what good things have happened to us. The gospel should by no means be anything differently. That's the greatest way that we have to share and be a witness for Christ, is to talk about the good things that God has done for us. Amen. Does anybody have anything they want to add before we close? Okay. All right. Anyone else? Yes.
I just wanted to say that everybody's been really praying for me and everything, because I have this excruciating sharp pain down inside my neck and my shoulder.
Yes.
For like 3-4 weeks. And this week, started about 3 days ago, it started getting better.
Oh, amen.
And I know it's from everybody's prayers.
Amen. Awesome. Praise God. I'm glad to hear that. Glad to hear that.
Yes, amen.
Anyone else? All right, if you will, let's join the Lord and we'll close out this. Father in heaven, we thank you, Father, for your word. Lord, and we've only been 2, maybe 3 weeks into just the very first scripture of your word, Father, in Romans. But Lord, there's so much there, Father, Lord, to be understood. But Father, I just pray that understanding, Father, is just, it's not just in our head, Father, Lord, but it goes to our heart and our soul, Father. Lord, and I pray that it encourages, Father, Lord, to see, Father, how we are still on this earth, Father, with a plan and a purpose, Father, Lord, to share the gospel as you have purposed for each one of us to do, Father. Lord, may we seek out your calling upon our lives, Father, Lord, to do what you have called us to do, Father. Lord, to be ministers of your gospel to those that may not have heard it. Your word says, how can they know if they have not heard? How can they hear, Lord, if we have not spoken it? Lord, I just pray that we seek, Father, Lord, to look and find how we are to serve you and to broadcast the good news of the gospel of your Son, Jesus Christ, to all who are around us. Father, we pray for Doug, Lord, and just ask for your hand of grace and mercy to be there in the hospital with them, Father. Lord, may your healing hand be at work, Father. Lord, above all things, we pray that your perfect will would be done, Father. May your glory, your grace, and your mercy be revealed in their time of need there, Father. Lord, pray that you would guide us and direct us into this new week, Father. Give us strength, boldness, and courage to live faithfully for you, Lord. And just pray for those opportunities, Lord, to share this gospel, to share this good news with those that don't know you. That seeds may be planted, Lord, and it may grow into salvation for them. Lord, that it may increase your kingdom for your honor, for your glory. It's in Jesus' name that we pray these things. Amen.